The date is July 12th, 2018. We're in Burbank, California for the first day of Overwatch League's inaugural season playoffs. The score is currently 2-0 in favor of the LA Gladiators, who are getting ready to begin their attack on King's Row. Everyone knows the stakes. The Gladiators just need to win this map to take home the first match of this best of three and hold a significant advantage over the London Spitfire for the rest of the series. For their part, London is just trying to stay alive. What follows is one of the most iconic trick plays in Overwatch League history. But how did we get here? The LA Gladiators have been through a lot to get to this point, so to fully appreciate this moment, we have to rewind. The LA Gladiators season got off to a rocky start. Instead of simply buying a top team in its entirety like some other Overwatch League franchises, LA opted to go for a team that mixed Overwatch veterans from all over the scene. Notable among them were the main tank iRemix of Kangarna, DPS Surefour from Cloud9, and the support duo of Big Goose and Shaz from Team Giganti. While these players were all individually talented, it became clear that there was a disconnect, a lack of team synergy. In addition, they didn't seem to have a true leader. The position you usually expect to lead, main tank, was especially inconsistent, with iRemix having several bad games in the first stage of the season. Because of this, LA floundered, going 4-6 by the end of stage 1. But here they are in the playoffs, so obviously they were able to turn things around. For that, they actually have to thank their opponents. London was kind of having the opposite problem. When Cloud9, who owned the Spitfire, were tasked with building an Overwatch League team, they basically looked at their already existing Korean team, Cloud9 Kongdu, and then they looked at GC Busan, who had just won Apex Season 4, and said, "What if we just smash them together?" What was a great plan on paper turned into a logistical nightmare, as London's 12-man roster simply had too many star players and alpha personalities to keep together. Chief among them was the main tank Fissure. Fissure was on the Cloud9 Kongdu side of things, and I'd bet that when he found out that his team had bought an Overwatch League spot, he figured that he had a starting spot all but wrapped up. But then Gesture came along from GC Busan and ruined everything. While Fissure is incredibly talented, he has an aggressive playstyle that demands a majority of his team's resources. Gesture had a more team-oriented playstyle, and as Stage 1 went on, it became clear that the Spitfire preferred this, as Gesture got a vast majority of the playtime en route to a Stage 1 championship. And that's all well and good, but a guy like Fissure didn't want to win by technicality. He wanted to win a championship with him on the stage. I wouldn't be shocked if he asked to get traded once he figured out that he wouldn't be getting much playtime, and all the Spitfire could do was deal him out and pray that it wouldn't bite them down the road. So a deal was made between stages 1 and 2 that transferred Fissure to the LA Gladiators. He started playing for them instantly, sending iRemix to the bench, and the difference was honestly night and day. Fissure completely changed LA's playstyle, in a good way. His aggressive Winston and Reinhardt play felt like a constant highlight reel, and it gave this team an identity, a driving force to play around. His mere presence seemed to kick everyone into a new gear. Surefour, who was just a mediocre hitscan player until now, grinded Widowmaker until he was one of the best in the world. Big Goose and Shaz were able to adapt to their team's needs, keeping them alive while also pulling off some incredible plays themselves. As the season went on, the Gladiators continued to pick up talented prospects like Void on off-tank and Silkthread on flex, and with their roster complete, LA really started to experiment with different comps and unorthodox hero choices. It paid off, as not only were the Gladiators one of the most fun teams to watch, they were one of the best. From 6-4 in stages 2 and 3 to 9-1 in stage 4, the Gladiators rose to the ranks, and by the end of the season, their record was 25-15, good enough for 4th place overall in qualifying for the playoffs. The Gladiators now had a clear path to the championship, and the team standing in their way could not be more poetic. Sitting in the 5th seed, below LA, the London Spitfire have clearly gone through their own set of troubles. After their Stage 1 championship, London struggled to find any consistency as the season raged on. The Spitfire would put forward several different starting rosters over this time, trying to get something to stick, but nothing they did was enough to recapture the spark that was on this team at the beginning. It got to the point where the team basically decided to kick off half of their roster so they could focus on a starting six. And while they are on a cold streak right now, this lineup is undeniably scary. You had Birdring in the hitscan DPS role, who had established himself as one of the best in the game in Stage 1. He was key to their championship at the time, but suffered a wrist injury shortly after. He missed a significant portion of the season, and even after he returned, it was clear that his play had taken a step back as a result. London fans are desperately hoping that he returns to form in this game. Even if he doesn't though, Prophet, who is one of the most clutch players in all of Overwatch, was sure to pick up the slack. You had Fury, who over the season established himself as one of the most consistently great off-tanks in the league. There was Bedosin, a flex support who knew how to make plays on Ana and Zenyatta. And then, of course, you had Gesture, the man who had benched Fissure to start the season and was looking to make sure that it would stay that way. So the stage was set, the Gladiators versus the Spitfire, with Fissure at the helm trying to stick it once and for all to the team that had benched him. But wait a second, where is Fissure? He's not in this game right now, nor has he been in this game at all. In fact, we didn't know this at the time, but Fissure would never play another game for this team ever again. That's because just an hour before game time, the Gladiators released a vague statement saying that Fissure would be benched, and that they believed this decision gave them their best chance to win. This came out of nowhere and made no sense, as the team's record the season with Fissure on the roster was clearly better than their record without him. To this day, we still don't really know what led to this decision. People have theorized that there were internal issues, that Fissure was always unhappy with his team and wasn't giving as much effort as management wanted him to. For what it's worth, Fissure has denied these theories, but no matter the reason, iRemix was set to play in the highest stakes game of his career after spending most of the last 5 months on the bench. With this new development, analysts' predictions for this game heavily swung in favor of London. I mean, how could the Gladiators win this without their fearless leader? But the score is 2-0 in favor of the Gladiators, so clearly LA were more than ready for the challenge. The Gladiators played a wide variety of comps and rosters, and London had trouble keeping up. Sure4 was doing a great job of keeping Birdring in check, and while iRemix definitely wasn't as flashy as Fissure, he didn't have to be. He just had to stay alive long enough for the rest of his team to do their jobs. And whether it was their pirate ship comp on Junkertown or flex DPS Hydration's Pharah on Lijiang, the Gladiators just seemed to be one step ahead going into halftime. And that brings us to now. All the Gladiators have to do is beat London's attack, 1 point in about 110 meters, and they prove all the doubters wrong. Win, and they prove that they're more than just Fissure. They prove that they're legitimate championship contenders no matter who is on the field. For London, their best chance of winning is probably to hold LA right at the spawn gates, don't even let them unlock the payload, and their high-powered comp of heroes like Junkrat, Roadhog, and Widowmaker seems designed to do just that. The Gladiators have to be watching out for Prophet, Birdring, and Bedosin. If they make one wrong move or get caught in one of Gesture's Orisa halts, one of these players is sure to take them out. But in a game of creative strategies, LA had the biggest trick up their sleeve for King's Row, a trick play that they called the Great Bamboozle. It required perfect coordination from everybody on the squad, perfect pathing on a part of the map that people don't usually go to, and most of all, Sure4 has to have perfect timing and precision with his shots. According to Hydration, it had never failed before in a scrim, but on stage, when the lights were brightest, who knows what could happen. But you can't think about that in these moments, you just have to go. The spawn doors open, and the Gladiators leave in a GOATS composition, an extremely brawly comp with no DPS heroes. Usually, this comp relies on its close-range damage and its ability to stay alive until its ultimates come online, but the Gladiators were using it for a different reason. They speed past the point, so clumped up that the Spitfire don't notice that Sure4 has been left at spawn. LA wraps all the way around the map to take some high ground that's on the far side of the point. London pivots to deal with this threat, completely unaware that they've exposed their backs to Sherfor, who has swapped to his signature Widowmaker. This is it. Can Sherfor land his shots and deal the decisive blow in this match? Welcome to A Moment in History.
I'ma call this the merry-go-round, because it makes me laugh, makes me happy, and Sherfor switches to the Widowmaker at just the right time! Closer drops down, and it's a day in the shooting range for Lane Roberts. The Canadian superstar unloads on the Spitfire, and they get completely smashed.
LA would close out this match 3-0, but London would come back, win the next two matches, and go on to win the entire season. But they weren't the victims of the Great Bamboozle, so who are the real winners here? Thank you all so much for watching, I hope you enjoyed. If you've made it to this point, I'd really appreciate it if you left a like and subscribed. Also, are there any other moments in esports that you think deserve a rewind like this? Let me know in the comments, it doesn't even have to be Overwatch related. Thanks everyone, and have a great rest of your day. Don't get tilted!